Good afternoon. I'm Sherry Stark, a member of First Presbyterian Church, and on behalf of all of the church, welcome, welcome. And on behalf of all of you, we welcome our wonderful, wonderful guest. We're so glad to have you here for the William R. Laws Peacemaking Lecture. This annual event was established by the Laws family using gifts given at the time of Bill's death. The Reverend Dr. Bill Laws was pastor here at First Presbyterian Church for many years. He was also a considerable influence in our community. Dr. Laws is credited, along with others, in spearheading efforts to create a more welcoming environment for people of color in Columbus. He also made his mark nationally when he was elected moderator of the General Assembly of the National Presbyterian Church in 1970. I encourage you to read the brief story that is in our program today about some of his work. Now I would ask you to join me in an opening prayer. Spirit of all life, look with loving kindness on those of us gathered in this place. We thank you for good and gracious peacemakers like Bill Laws and Lee Hamilton. Bless us with love, compassion, and growing consciousness as we listen and learn together. Help us to be good neighbors as we build safe, creative, and loving communities in which all children are cared for and all people supported in their growth and fulfillment. Help us to be mindful and caring towards family, friends, and those we meet, honoring their diverse paths and faiths. We pray for peace and justice at home and all across the world. This we ask, each in his or her own way, but for many of us, in the name and spirit of Jesus Christ. Amen. So, we are delighted that the Honorable Lee Hamilton is returning as our peacemaking speaker. I had the pleasure of introducing him when he spoke here many years ago. But we thought this time we should ask a person who knows our speaker really, really, really well. And that would be his daughter, Tracy Hamilton Susan. Tracy is president and CEO of Heritage Fund, the community foundation of Bartholomew County. And I might add, she is in her own right a wonderful community leader and dynamo. Tracy.
Thank you, Sherry, and let me extend my welcome to all of you. A number of years ago, I had the opportunity to introduce Erwin Miller at a Columbus Human Rights Commission dinner. And I remember being very, very excited and very, very terrified at the thought of introducing Mr. Miller while he was sitting right there. And I'll have to admit, as I prepared for this, having the same kind of feelings thinking about introducing my dad when he is sitting right here. But that was a fun time, and I remember working very hard on that introduction and seeking some advice and counsel. And I asked my dad, you know, what's the best thing to do? And he told me, well, remember, nobody really cares about the introduction. They're all there to hear the speaker. So, and as if to support Dad during that dinner, Mrs. Miller leaned over and she told me, she said, now dear, don't make the same mistake everybody else does and go on and on about Erwin. Just turn the podium over to him. So now you understand my dilemma. I promised Joe Lucas and Sherry Stark that I would do this introduction. So I've been debating what do I say or not say about Lee Hamilton. And I don't really consider myself an authority on many things, but I can speak as an authority on what it was like to grow up as Lee Hamilton's daughter. There are two other people in this world who could speak to that experience, and that would be my sister, Deb Kramer, who is here, and my brother, Doug Hamilton. They know what it was like to grow up with Lee Hamilton as your father. So the three of us shared that experience, and I suspect there'd be three very different answers to that question, but today you get mine. So, you know, my take on it is growing up as Lee Hamilton's daughter was extraordinary. It was terrific. About 80% of it was probably normal family give and take dynamics, but 20% of it was extraordinary. Moments we experienced this past November when 9 family members were able to gather at the White House and where Dad received the Presidential Medal of Freedom, which is the highest honor given to a civilian. It was an absolutely magical and extraordinary afternoon meeting the President and Mrs. Obama and seeing Dad up on that stage chatting away with Steven Spielberg, James Taylor, Barbara Streisand, and Dad's favorite, Willie Mays. And that wasn't the only opportunity that we had growing up, being able to go to the White House and meet a sitting president. But my parents also hosted a number of famous people at their home. I remember Tip O'Neill and Betty Ford being among those they entertained. But there were also TV interviews. Coming downstairs one morning, Candy Crowley of CNN was sitting in the living room interviewing Dad, and nobody had thought to mention that before, the night before. You know, my kids grew up knowing their grandfather was a guy on TV. Our oldest daughter, Christina, was a toddler during the Iran-Contra hearings, and she would stand in front of that TV set and she would put her hands on either side of Dad's face and say, "Talk to me, Papa Lee, talk to me." And we couldn't quite get her to understand. 10 years later, her sister, the youngest one, studied the Iran-Contra hearings in college at Oberlin in a political science class and never told the professor that her grandfather was Chairman Hamilton. I also remember as a young child, Dad coming into the room one night when I had nightmares about the Russians attacking Washington, D.C. And he sat on the end of my bed and explained to me the nuclear defense system of the United States. And I found that very comforting at the time. Kind of like when he took on the 9/11 commission. You know, I was also comforted that he was then watching out for the United States and making sure that that never happened again. And then there were interesting times like the 1992 presidential campaign when Dad was under consideration as Bill Clinton's running mate. Matt and I had a newborn at home at the time and 2 small daughters. And the Clinton campaign sent a very young staffer out to Columbus, Indiana to live with us for 2 days. And I have to agree with my mom on that process. It was just over the top in terms of annoying. But it was definitely extraordinary. But most of the time, you know, Dad was just Dad. He could be a disciplinarian. That was mostly for me because Deb and Doug were kind of ideal children. Deb and I could always count on Dad to do something embarrassing when a date came to pick us up at the house, or when someone asked Dad to speak at Doug's crew team during high school, during his rowing career there. And building audience rapport, Dad stood up and said, "You know, I'm from Indiana, and the only shell we know in Indiana is a gas station." And that didn't go over real well with those of us sitting along the Potomac River at the time. But you get the idea. Deb, Doug, and I were so very fortunate to grow up in the Hamilton household, and we still get together whenever we can. This is a great opportunity this weekend to get together, not only for this lecture today, but also to celebrate Dad's 85th birthday, which will be next week. So tomorrow we'll all gather and enjoy a spaghetti and meatballs birthday celebration because that is the Lee Hamilton birthday request. So one more extraordinary event, and we're delighted to be here, and I am delighted to introduce to you my extraordinary father, Lee Hamilton.
I held my breath through the entire introduction. Tracy, you gave a very gracious introduction, but boy, I was thinking all the time what you could have said. I'm delighted to be here. One question on my mind as I sat here: how many of you knew personally Bill and Ellen Laws? Laws? A good many of you. Well, I have a lot of memories of Bill Laws. Bill didn't spend very much time on the amenities. He would meet me out here on Washington Street when I was in the house, and he'd say, "Good morning, Lee. I want to talk to you about that vote you cast last week." Some of you may remember that in 1960, we had a Methodist minister by the name of Albert Ashley at the First Methodist Church. Albert was a wonderful man, a Southern Democrat. But on the Sunday before the election of 1960, he spent the entire sermon telling the congregation why they should vote against John F. Kennedy, because he was a Catholic. I got pretty upset. Bill Laws saw me the next day, and he said, "Lee, I always told you that Presbyterians were a lot more tolerant and magnanimous than Methodists." I could go on and on about Bill Laws. He was a marvelous spirit, as was his wife, Ellen, and I'm very glad to be here for this lecture. I want to say a word about Sherry. Sherry served with Bob Stewart when he was mayor, a marvelous mayor of this community, and did so much work for him. We're very grateful to you for the contributions that you made. And it's great for me to look out over and see so many of you that I have known a good many years. The only difference is you look a lot older. And I'm certainly glad that I'm the only one that doesn't look older. But it's good to be with you. And you've given me an assignment. And the assignment is to talk about peacemaking, which I'll take a crack at. And then we'll have some Q&A, right, afterwards. I think we'll operate under the usual rule, and that is that if the question is easy, I'll take it. If it's hard, Sherry will take it. The Middle East is unraveling. Four countries are failing. At least four, maybe more. Libya, Syria, Iraq, and Yemen, and probably Afghanistan, and maybe another one or two. This is an historic moment in the Arab world, really historic. You've got 21 or 22 nations that are rattling, crumbling, and fragmenting. Their legitimacy, durability, and efficacy are in question. They cannot deliver ordinary services to their people. ISIS grows in lethality, if not in scope. Europe is staggering with massive refugee flows and a weak economic growth. A united Europe, which was one of the great achievements of the latter part of the last century, is in danger of fraying. Russia is once again a geopolitical threat. Asia is strained by the economic slowdown. North Korea is working hard to put a bomb to a missile, one that can reach the United States. World trade talks have hit a wall. World organizations like the United Nations are struggling for relevance. Climate change discussions have had some progress, but only secured non-binding national pledges. In short, the world is a complicated, tough, messy place, full of hardship, tragedy, and devilishly difficult problems. The foreign policy debate in the United States among our political leadership is, for the most part, embarrassing. The gap between the level of debate and the level of complexity and seriousness of the problems facing the new president is simply breathtaking and disappointing. The Congress, supposedly a partner with the president in the making of American foreign policy, is nowhere to be seen. Indeed, it cannot even pass a budget, and has not since the middle of the 1990s. We had a conference the other day in Bloomington. We brought in a lot of national security experts from all over the country, some really top-notch talent, men and women. And they agreed on an interesting thing. I hadn't really thought of it this way. They agreed that in many ways, our most serious foreign policy problem is our domestic disunion and disability or dysfunction. The excessive political polarization and the way in which issues become automatically politicized. So it's in this setting that you and I come together on a beautiful afternoon. Indeed, I question your judgment. Anybody who would come to listen to a lecture on a day like this has to have a question raised about their judgment. But I'm delighted you're here, and I thank you for it. The sheer number and complexity of the issues are mind-boggling. I cannot recall a time when the issues before an incoming president are more difficult. But the stakes are monumental. The consequences for you and our children and grandchildren are very high. The United States is the only global power and the power to whom almost every country in the world turns for leadership. The questions just cascade upon us. How do we make peace in this troubled, chaotic world? Where do we begin? Where, when, and how do we assert our leadership? What are the priority threats? I read a bunch of experts the other day. There were five or six of them. They were asked to give us the major national threat to the United States, and they gave five or six answers, not one. How do we better communicate with the American people about our problems in the world? Some decades ago, I sat down in the president's office with President Lyndon Johnson and his chief of staff, a man by the name of Harry McPherson. Some of you wonks may remember that name, not many of you would. Harry was a brilliant Texas lawyer. We were discussing a very challenging foreign policy problem, and Harry laid out the issues with precision and clarity. Then he gave a list of possible options, the pros and the cons. And I just marveled at his ability to lay out the problem for the president. And then he stopped. President Johnson looked at him, rubbed that big hammy fist of his across his cheek, and he said, "Harry, therefore," and he paused. Johnson knew the issues. He knew the pros and the cons. He wanted to hear the recommendations. And then he said, "Harry, what do I do now?" And I've heard that question from a president many times. After brilliant briefings, what do I do now? I'm going to try to answer. How long you got? It's going to take a while. What'd you say, 3 hours? I don't know. If anybody wants to get up and walk out, go right ahead. I've walked out of so many meetings, it doesn't make any difference to me. But I'll try to cover a little ground here. What do we do now? Well, the first thing I want to say is that I want the United States to be a benign power, kinder, gentler. The U.S. should be at the forefront of every global initiative to respond to famine, earthquakes, floods, epidemics like the Zika virus, coming to the aid of distressed people, providing them protection from harm and services essential to their survival. Our military forces are the only institution in the world which can mobilize quickly, massively, in response to a natural disaster in the world, fly in food and water and housing, medical supplies, as we did in Indonesia and Japan a few years back. Such actions reflect the generosity and the decency of the American people. And obviously, they greatly, significantly improve the image of the United States. Now, there are limitations, of course, of what we can do. And believe it or not, there is some opposition to what we do when we try to do it, but that should not deter us. If you sit down today with Middle East leaders and ask them, describe the U.S. counterterrorism policy, they will give you the U.S. counterterrorism policy in one word: drones. Now, shooting off drones at targeted killings may be necessary. According to the polls, most Americans support it overwhelmingly. But they should not be the sum and substance of American foreign policy. We're better than just shooting drones off. Let us strive to be a power that promotes our values, democracy, human rights, liberty, and justice for all. And incidentally, I hear a lot of speeches and see a lot of publicity these days about freedom and liberty. You're for that, I'm for that. But you know what the pledge says, don't you? Liberty and justice. Both, not just freedom, not just liberty, liberty and justice for all. And we want to try to achieve these elusive goals and use all of our tools, trade, investment, development, humanitarian aid, striving to be perceived on the side of those who seek to be treated decently. I want America to be seen as the country that helps ordinary people live a decent life. That's where you begin. A kinder, gentler power. The next thing I want to say is that I think it's necessary for us to foster interactions among American citizens and foreigners. That's pretty obvious. I've always been impressed with the power of the non-governmental sector in international affairs. You hear about foreign policy, it's always government to government. The president does this, the president does that, or the other foreign leader does something. That's obviously very important. But underlying it all are the contacts that are made in the non-governmental sector, in the business community, in the NGO community, that give a substance and firm foundation to a relationship. And often I have had the experience of sitting down with a number of foreign leaders who have a much broader understanding of the United States because they studied here or worked here before they went back to their countries and became leaders. American civil society in all of its multiple forms has an enormous wealth of knowledge, resources, talented people, institutional sophistication that can be a great asset. And I want us to flood the world with farmers and doctors and teachers and educators and students. I want the foreign students to come here. I'm thrilled when I see all those foreign students at Indiana University. I encourage our students to go there to study, wherever there may be. I want American students to go abroad. That happened to me. I'd hardly been outside the state of Indiana. The only thing I knew as a kid was basketball. I went abroad, and boy, did it ever open my eyes. These exchanges may not change the equation in the short term, but the longer term impact is profound. They increase understanding, they broaden sympathies, they spread American values. I once knew a very prominent United States official. I don't know whether I should use his name or not. I think I will. He's not here. You're not going to tell him, are you? Senator Bradley, remember that name from New Jersey? He said if it was up to him, he'd put the entire aid budget into student exchanges. All of it. And I come very close to agreeing with him. The next thing I'd say is that we need to deploy U.S. diplomats across the world where possible and appropriate to diffuse tensions and resolve conflicts and build consensus. You know the political skill that is most needed in the United States and in the world today? It's the ability to build consensus behind a solution. That's real political skill. Anybody can go into a room where you have disparate opinions and blow it apart. I know I've done it several times. What's really hard is to go into that room and bring people together. Sometimes it takes not one meeting, but a dozen meetings. That's political skill of the highest order. It's needed in politics today. My guess is it may even be needed in the Presbyterian Church. You need it in every endeavor of human people. Building solutions behind a remedy of some kind. You know, politics is all about a search for a remedy. That's what it's all about. I know there's a lot of noise out there. There's a lot of messiness out there. There's a lot of things you don't like about it. A lot of things I don't like about it. But underneath it all is a search for a remedy. What a marvelous thing for America to be known and its diplomats to be known as peacemakers and problem solvers. Everywhere in the world, we've got the skill, we've got the talent in the private and the public sectors to do it. American military power, don't get me wrong here, is necessary, but not sufficient by itself. And among other things we have to do is be willing to engage in talks with not just our friends and allies, but also our adversaries. Now that's going to make some of you kind of nervous out there. I don't mind making you nervous. I'm not running for anything. You cannot make peace just talking to your friends. You have to talk with your adversaries. And not talking is a near guarantee that the problem will fester and opportunities for peace will be missed. Now let's take a case in point. North Korea. Oh, this will make you squirm. Hamilton believes we ought to talk with North Korea, and I do. Our position with North Korea has been, it's changing now, but for a long, long time under a variety of presidents, before we'll sit down and talk with them, North Korea had to give up its nuclear weapons. North Korea is not going to do that. They know it. We know it. That formula is a non-starter, and it has been. The result? No talks. And for decades, North Korea has continued to build the bomb. How's that for effectiveness? You got to talk with them. I don't suggest that talking is going to be easy. I'm not suggesting we put a moral stamp of approval on the North Koreans. I'm not suggesting they're not a communist country that has been harsh indeed upon their people. All of those things are true and much more. You can have a lot of arguments now about timing and when you sit down and talk and when you don't. That's another question. But there's a large group of American people who take great pride in not talking to people we disagree with. And I do not believe that is a path that can lead to peace. If you can reach peace by not talking to people, I'd like to see it. Ronald Reagan told Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall. You remember that? Every American nodded their head with great approval. That very week, Ronald Reagan sent negotiators to Moscow to negotiate. All through the Cold War, every president of every persuasion kept dealing with the Soviet Union. I know they'd come out on the stump and they'd talk about rolling back Soviet power. I heard those speeches. I heard the speeches about the evil empire. Those things are true. But I also know what they did. And what they did was they negotiated with the Soviet Union. And what happened? We eventually resolved the Cold War in our favor and without firing a shot. diplomatic power is not a panacea. It doesn't always work, but it's often been an effective tool in dealing with some of the toughest problems we have. It takes patience and perseverance, and it often works. And I don't believe that we should reach for the gun too quickly. We should first reach for the purse, aid, economic and political leverage, investment, trade, energy resources, technology, and all of the non-military tools available to a global power. I know the temptation, I've seen it again and again. The American military has enormous and impressive capabilities. It's a tool ready to use. A president of the United States, when he has a problem in front of him, asks several questions. One question is, first of all, what are the facts? That's not a bad idea. That's a good start, isn't it? What are the facts? Incidentally, very hard to answer because the facts keep changing on you. They're dynamic. Then he asks, what are the American core interests? What's the American interest today in Syria? Anybody want to get up and tell me? You're spending a lot of money there. You're putting troops there now. You want to spell it out? How does that affect Columbus, Indiana? What are the core interests of the United States in this Middle East I described in the opening remarks? Or Iraq? Or Afghanistan? You ready to send your son and daughter to fight in those areas and die to protect them? We have to think very hard, I'll say this again in a little bit, very hard about what our national interests really are. Now, the military can do so many good things. They can conquer territory, they can control territory, but they usually cannot solve the underlying political and economic problems. That takes a political settlement. That means talking, talking, talking. I was in Baghdad one day. I ran into an army captain. I asked him, what do you do? That's a fair question, isn't it? What do you do? He said that he was setting up a school system on the outskirts of Baghdad. I asked him if he had any training to do that. He said, no. He said, I'm a combat infantryman, and I quote him now, you'll not like this. I am trained to kill people. Now, to the credit of the American military, they've been quick of necessity to try to adopt civilian capabilities, and so that captain was trying to set up a school system. But it's taken us a long time. So military power, and this is the point, is a valuable tool. It has to be available. It cannot be ignored. On occasion, it has to be used. But it should be a tool of last resort. Skip over a lot of good stuff.
10 minutes.
10 minutes. Well, we've got to help other nations improve their institutions of government, the parliaments, the media, the bureaucracies, the civil society. We have to be a source of knowledge for other nations and build the institutions that are necessary. We're not aware of all of those institutions until we begin to think about it. It's not just government, it's not just the Congress, or it's the bureaucracies, it's a state, it's local government, it's all kinds of institutions that are necessary. And we have to be very careful here. Every nation has their own ideas, their own interests, their own culture, their own politics, their own history. We cannot go charging into these nations and ignoring those things. I talked one time to one of our top generals in Iraq, after he'd been through, I don't know, three or four tours of duty there. And he said to me, as he's coming back to Washington one day, he said to me, he said, Lee, we've never really understood these people. We spent decades there. We've never really understood these people. I think President Obama had it right when he went to Cuba. He made it very careful, if you'll recall, when he specifically rejected that we were there for a regime change. Remember that when he was there? You remember the Cubans? The Cubans still think about the Bay of Pigs when we tried to overthrow the government, right? They remember that. We don't, they do. So when the president went down there and said, I'm not interested in regime change, it's for the Cuban people to make that choice, that's the right note, I believe. Oh, boy. We got to get our own political and economic house in order. I don't know if you realize the importance of that. Go back to that conference I mentioned earlier on. The most important thing we got to do is make our own country work. Our shortcomings here at home directly threaten our ability to project power, to exert influence overseas, to compete in the global marketplace. If the United States remains a nation and an idea worth emulating, we have to work at it, and we have to improve our own country. If we're unable to provide a decent standard of living for our people, if we're not inclusive, oh my goodness, inclusivity. I went to high school in Central, Evansville, decades ago. We had 130 million people in the country. What do we got now? 300 and whatever it is, 20 million. In my working lifetime, the country has far more than doubled. But not only that, it's become much, much more diverse. Several of our major states today have a majority of voters who are non-white. That'll shake you up. Take a look at this audience. Not too much diversity out there. This country's changing. You may like it, you may not like it. Doesn't make any difference. It's changing. And that's what's behind a lot of the unease in the country today. The culture is changing, and it makes a lot of people uneasy. And I can understand that, you can understand. But we have to make our own country work. And the conduct of American foreign policy is going to be much, much more difficult if we're not able to do so. The last point I'll make, no, it's not the last, I'm gonna make two more points. I may make three more points. Depends on how many things come to my mind. How much time you got? But we need help, and I'll make this point very short. Whatever problem you think is big time, I can guarantee you we cannot solve it by ourselves. We need help. How are you going to solve the problem of immigration without talking to Mexico? How are you going to talk about solving the problem of nuclear proliferation without talking to Russia? How are you going to solve climate change by yourself? You're not going to get very far. And so in any major issue you can think of today, I am tempted to say without exception, is transnational, the refugee crisis, global climate change, immigration, banking, financial, economic policies, drugs, international crime, environmental degradation. You cannot solve those problems without help. So we have to cooperate with other nations and work with them. Now look, I've mentioned a lot of things here. We can't solve every problem. Our resources are limited. We can't fix everything everywhere every time. We have to set priorities. We have to consult. We have to deliberate. We have to think. But I believe that little can be accomplished in this world without American leadership. I believe that. I've seen it over and over again, how nations turn to us for leadership. And we've got a lot of assets. We have to be smart and analyze our problems carefully and think hard about them and ask ourselves, do I want to send the young men and young women of this community into dangerous places? That's the key test. That's the key test. Pretty doggone easy for Lee Hamilton to sit up in the United States Congress or Indiana University and say, we ought to be sending more young people over there. And I go home to a nice dinner and a good shower and a comfortable home. I've been on these front lines in Baghdad and Iraq and Afghanistan. I've been to Vietnam many, many years ago. I know what these people go through who are fighting. I know what the soldiers who go out into the patrols, into the jungles, come back with their fingernails bitten down to the quick, their nicotine-stained fingers so brown you can hardly see the white flesh. I know what 18 and 19-year-olds are called upon to do when we send them abroad. And it makes me think hard about deciding what and where and when to use our power. I really will conclude now. And this is a different question, really. So often I'm asked, and I bet you are too, are you optimistic or pessimistic about the future of the United States? Ever had that question come up? I'm going to give you an answer. You won't like it. I'm going to give it to you anyway. It may be a little facetious. The answer is it doesn't make any difference what you and I think. None at all. You don't know the future of the United States. And neither do I. We can make a guess, but we don't know. What's more important than what you and I think about our nation's future is what we do about it. What we do about its peacemaking capabilities. What we do to make our corner of the world, our neighborhood, our community, our state, our country, better, stronger, more peaceful. You and I love this country. It's been marvelous to us. I suspect there'd be unanimous agreement on that here. Woodrow Wilson had it right. He said, the country is always a morning. I used to work at the Wilson Center in Washington. I'd get a bonus every time I'd mention Woodrow Wilson in a speech. I got in the habit of it, so I threw it in tonight. But isn't that a wonderful word? The country is always a morning. We're always striving for a more perfect union. Our future is in our hands. I was with a group the other day. They said, where are the Abraham Lincolns? You ever heard that question put to you? I've been to those monuments in Washington. You have too. I used to get discouraged now and then. I'd get up from my desk. I'd walk a long way down the mall to see those magnificent statues of Martin Luther King, Abraham Lincoln and Thomas Jefferson and Teddy Roosevelt and on. And I'd be inspired by the words carved into granite, and I'd say to myself, where are the Lincolns and the Jeffersons and the Teddy Roosevelts? And then it occurred to me, they stand mute. They've done their part. And the future is in our hands. We made our problems. not Abraham Lincoln. We made them. And we have to solve them. So my concern is that we be better educated, better informed, more sympathetic, more compassionate, better understanding of our changing, challenging, dangerous world, and support a revitalization of a kinder, gentler United States leadership in the world. Good outcomes are possible, but they are not inevitable. The future could bring order or chaos, peace or war, prosperity or poverty, or something in between. But whatever challenges we face, American leadership is going to count.
We're so fortunate now that Mr. Hamilton has agreed to answer some questions. We have microphones, so if you'll raise your hand, the mic will be brought to you. Please give us your name. We've got one down here. Vern, are you ready? Right down here front. State your name and ask the question, and then we will turn to our guest for response.
My name is Ron Denke. I'm from Columbus. Years ago, I heard you lecture shortly after you retired, and you indicated your big regret was the loss of civility in Congress. And we're witnessing that today in our campaigns. I think this question is appropriate to what you've been talking about now. What will it take, or do you see a time when civility will be restored in our government?
I think the question you ask is on the minds of a lot of people today, maybe even the most important question on their mind. Let me just say that civility is a lubricant. It is a lubricant in every worthy human transaction. If you do not have civility, the chances of reaching an agreement are very slim. You have to have civility. One of my great pleasures is remembering Ronald Reagan and Tip O'Neill. Ronald Reagan was the great conservative. Tip O'Neill, the great liberal. We used to meet in the cabinet room from time to time to discuss issues of some consequence. And I don't want to say those conversations were easy. They were not. Tensions would rise. But no one that I can remember ever became uncivil. And when those tensions would rise, Ronald Reagan would pass out the jelly bean jar. And then he'd offer you a jelly bean, and he would give you a psychoanalysis on the color of the bean and your personality. I chose red one time. That was a big mistake. Tip O'Neill had 100 stories about clam bakes in Boston. I heard one or two of them 5 or 6 times. I could repeat them if you wanted to hear them. I know you don't, but I could repeat them. So civility is terribly important. Now, I think you're right. We have often seen in our public life today excessive partisanship. Now, let me be clear here. You must expect in a democratic society robust debate. Don't expect everybody to agree with you. Don't fall off your chair if somebody disagrees with you. Robust debate and partisanship is necessary. But there is such a thing, is there not, as excessive partisanship. And I know the line can be hard to draw, but it has to be drawn. I think there's a rhythm to American political life, and I hope we'll get back to that civility. I think you and I have a job, and that's to let people know in public life that you want them to behave with respect to others. What are we talking about with civility? What we're really talking about is respect for the other guy. Now look, it's very easy to me to be civil with you folks. You're all nice people, right? Not one bad egg in the bunch. The test of civility is when you're dealing with somebody you don't like. For whatever reason, good, bad, or indifferent. That's the test. To deal politely, respectfully, with positions that you don't agree with, and you just think they're dead wrong. So it's terribly important, and I think our job is to let the politicians know. I'll give you an example of myself. I was watching one day C-SPAN, and a friend of mine, I'm a Democrat, he was a Democrat. He was giving a speech that I thought was on the mark, but he was just awful. And in the way he was attacking the motivation of the other side, I called him up. I knew him. I said, you had a good speech, but I thought it was awful. And I said, you have to be civil. I should do that more. You should too. Let the politicians know that you want civility. You want to treat people with respect. George Washington, when he was 16 years old, wrote out 100 rules of conduct. The first rule was, treat every person in the room with respect.
Another question? Yes. Madeline. We have a question from Madeline.
What is one of the best quotes that you liked?
What's the question?
Quote.
Well, in this context, I think of let us have peace and let it begin with me. That's a pretty good quote for the day. But like you, this is a remarkable young lady. Stand up so everybody can see you here. Give her a hand. The reason I call her remarkable is she's doing a study on Lee Hamilton. real perception, that young lady, real, real perception. She's a wonderful young lady, and that's the best I can come up with on the short term.
Yeah. Other questions? Hyman, Judge Hyman.
Yes, Steve Hyman.
Steve.
President,
we wish you well. You're stepping aside, right?
Pardon me?
You're stepping aside as judge?
Well, we
thank you for your service.
Thank you. I did read that in the paper, so. President Eisenhower, when he was leaving office, warned us about the military-industrial complex. To what extent, if any, is the military-industrial complex guiding our foreign policy?
To a very large extent. The State Department now is second in importance in American diplomacy to the Defense Department. I don't know what the figures are offhand. We send something like several hundred times more on the defense budget than we do the diplomatic budget. But I'll tell you a very specific illustration of this that I've seen several times. You're in Baghdad, and the central commander comes in for a visit. He flies in a 707, United States of America. He comes off the airplane with 50 aides, and he makes his visits around to the foreign minister and the president and so forth, with that great entourage of people with notebooks this thick. The next day, the diplomat, assistant secretary of state, comes in commercially, gets off the plane by himself. Who's going to impress the foreign minister more? So I'm worried about that. Eisenhower was right to give us that warning. Now, I hope I expressed throughout my remarks a respect for the American military, because I genuinely have a lot of respect for them. But I do think that we reach for the gun too quickly. Give the American military too much power in non-military matters. They become, in effect, the chief diplomats. And we need to start about the balance.
Other question?
Yes.
Roger, in the back.
Roger Brinkman, you started to say at the onset of your speech that the first thing we really need to do is get our country in order. And I'm wondering, how do you see that happening, and do you see it happening?
It's not complicated. In parliamentary terms, it's a return to regular order. In more lay terms, we have a system in this country that has served us very well for 230 years. It's worked in the economy, in economic depressions, it's worked in world wars, it's worked in civil wars. It works. Not easily, but it works. And we simply have to return to the way we've done business in the past. Now, let me give it to you in specific terms. The budget of the United States government. The way we have handled the budget of the United States government for 200 years was we broke it down into the Defense Department, the State Department, the Justice Department, the Agriculture Department, and so forth, and enacted separate appropriation bills. Those bills were handled in subcommittee. A member of Congress could offer an amendment, up or down, vote, take it to the committee, arguments, up and down, vote, take it to the floor, arguments, up and down, vote. And it worked. Now, what's happened today? The Congress of the United States cannot pass a budget. They go to the omnibus bill. Have you heard of the omnibus bill? The omnibus bill is an abomination. It violates every rule of good process you can think about. It's put together in the dead of night, in secret, by staff, not by members. It's put together at 3 a.m. It's voted on at 10 a.m. for an up or down vote. No amendments are permitted. That's the way the budget of the United States is now being adopted in both the Senate and the House. It is an unmitigated outrage. It violates every sense of accountability, transparency, due process. So it's just a matter. It is a matter of returning to a process that has served us well for 200 years. It is not that complicated. And when you talk to your favorite representative, ask them when they're going to pass a budget according to regular order. And ask them why they support a budget that is not done that way. I got to the place where I voted against the omnibus bills just because I was so appalled at the process. I wanted the opportunity as a member to offer an amendment. Look, if I offered an amendment on the floor, and with all of my persuasive powers, can you imagine that? Say, sometimes they turn me down. They voted against an amendment I offered. Can you believe that? But I couldn't complain, could I? Because I had a shot at it. I had an opportunity. Now they don't have that. They put it together in the dark. Now who likes it? I'll tell you who likes it. The leadership of the Congress likes it because it gives them the power. I'll tell you who likes it. The President of the United States likes it because he doesn't have to deal with 535 members of the Congress. He deals with a handful of them. And that's a lot easier. So there, I'll tell you who likes it. The special interest groups. They like it because they don't have to deal with 535 people. They just need to deal with the guy who writes the regulation or puts the comma in. I used to wonder why the CEOs of America, the 500 largest corporations, would come to Capitol Hill and walk around Capitol Hill to meet guys like me. Now these are important people. They got big time responsibilities. They employ tens of thousands of people. And they're spending time, and it's still happening, on Capitol Hill, walking up and down the halls of the Congress, going in to see the Lee Hamiltons there and asking them to do so. Why do they do it? They do it because of the payoff. If they can get that language changed, if they can get the comma put in the right place, their company is going to benefit not by a few million, which they'll spend on lobbying, by millions or hundreds of millions of dollars. So the special interest fight. When the American people begin to understand what has happened in the process, they'll rebel. I'm confident of that. That's a heck of a note to end on. Go back to the regular order. Let's take one more vote. I've told you about everything I know. I'll take one more vote.
One more, John.
I'm John McCune from this church. And I wanted to report to you, if you haven't heard, that this church has recently undertaken the sponsorship of a Syrian refugee family, seven members of one family, a grandmother, a father and mother, and four children. We met with the family yesterday in Indianapolis and were overwhelmed by the gratitude and the sense of opportunity that this has given us. This all came about largely from seeing a picture of a little boy washed ashore on the floor of the shore of the Aegean Sea. And I'd like to hear your comments on the refugee situation.
Well, my first comment is congratulations to you and your colleagues. The integration of refugees into this country is not a problem for President Obama. It's a problem for you. Integration occurs at the local level, not in Washington, D.C. And you're acting, I think, in a most admirable way. Now, the refugee problem is a serious problem, for sure. And many things have to be done. Just downright plain humanitarian aid is a big part of it. You got to give them food, you got to give them water, you got to give them sanitation, you got to give them a house or a tent to live in. That's a big part of it. But the fundamental problem we have not addressed, and the fundamental problem is governance. These people are leaving Afghanistan and Iraq and Syria because the countries can't help them, or don't help them, or whatever the reason. There's no future for them. They can't get a job. Their children can't get a job. I'd run too. You would too, if you're healthy. Get out of there. Go north. And suffer all kinds of hardships. So, if you're really going to solve the refugee problem, you've got to help on the humanitarian side for sure. You've got to do what you're doing to try to get people integrated into our communities. I flat out don't agree with these politicians who are talking about building a wall and that kind of stuff. That's so you're doing the right thing. But we've got to figure out a way to help these people govern themselves better. Now, this is a horrendously difficult problem. I said in the speech that we have the ability to help other nations build institutions of democracy and decency. And I think we do, and I think we should do that the best we can. But I'll tell you something I left out of my speech, and I'll give it to you now. I believe in tough love. If a country is not willing to step up to its responsibilities to provide a decent living for their people and a decent opportunity, if they're not willing to do that, I don't think we're doing it. We're not smart enough. We don't have enough resources. And there are plenty of other people that need the help. Hard-hearted. But I've seen so many resources in the American taxpayer poured down the drain trying to help people who won't help themselves. Now, I don't expect miracles here, but you have to set metrics about their performance, and if the political leadership of the country is unwilling to take basic steps towards a more open, transparent society, I don't expect one man, one vote. Jeffersonian democracy, we have trouble with Jeffersonian democracy in Indiana. You get the point. So governance is a problem. We really got to work on the world. Thank you very much.
So powerful, so powerful, and really encouraging. Thank you, thank you. Bill Law's daughter Marty is not able to be here, but she said in a note to Joe Lucas, what this world needs is more people like Lee Hamilton, and I think we all would agree with that. So my suggestion to you, just before we leave, Diane, are you able to play Happy Birthday? It seems to me, since we understand from Tracy, let's all stand and sing to Lee Hamilton. Charge he gave us and make a difference.